Fathers, love everyone and welcome. Today, as we continue our series of false light and false love, we're going to have a panel discussion with Johanna and the others. Just sort of a nice free-for-all discussion that I think can be helpful. So as always, kick back and relax, and let's see what kind of truth the Spirit can reveal today.
Be sure you're in the true faith, following the one true God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and the one true Savior, Jesus Christ of Nazareth. We talked about Jesus' calling and how you can be following another Jesus, as warned about in 2 Corinthians 11 or in Matthew 24, where Jesus warns about, you know, false Christs. And the scripture that I had was from 2 Corinthians 13:5. Examine yourselves, whether you be in the faith. Prove your own selves. Know ye not your own selves how that Jesus Christ is in you, except you be reprobates. And another scripture that comes to mind is Ephesians 4:27, which is neither give place to the devil. When you get involved with one of these seducing spirits or books that are coming from the spirit world that are getting in there and mixing their things in there, it's almost like, I was trying to think of an example, but it's almost like one termite just getting in there and then just starting to do its work. And before you know it, the foundations can be taken away. And we talked about how the new foundation that the devil is trying to create for a world view, world religion, new spirituality is that God is in everyone and everything. So if you're starting to accept these views, like if you didn't notice that the Jesus of the Shack said that, or that Rick Warren just knocked that off as one of his teachings, same thing in the message, then it's sort of slipping past you. And I think maybe after some talks like we've had here, you'll start to kind of like, if another book comes through and you see that, you know, that God's in everything, you'll go, whoops, there it is. And right away you'll know something's up. And there are just some telltale signs like that. But you don't have to become experts in the occult. Believe me, you don't need to do that. You don't need to read occult books. But just be alert to some of these things. So examine yourself to see if you're in the faith.
And you know, Warren, I'd like to add to that because he's exactly right. Unless you know which Jesus you're following, you're in big trouble. And examine yourself to see if you're in the faith is exactly right. You know, as Acts 4 says, there is salvation in no one else. There is no other name given under heaven among men by which we must be saved. Unless you believe I am he, Jesus said, you will die in your sins. But what do you do when you've got, for example, and let me give you a few quotes, because some of the people in these Christian aberrant, apostate, heretical movements think they're in the faith. Oh, yes, I believe in Jesus, to which I reply, hunky-dory, which one? For example, Kenneth Copeland, July 19th, 1987, and by the way, he's never repudiated or changed this. Pray to yourself, because I'm in yourself and you're in myself. You don't have a God in you, you are one. When I read in the Bible where he, Jesus, says, I am, I say, yes, I am too. Examine yourself to see you're in what faith? Remember we talked last night about his bragging in Believer's Voice of Victory, 9th February 1987 edition, where he says Jesus manifested himself to him and he said, don't be disturbed when people accuse you of thinking you're God. The more you get to be like me, the more they're going to think that way of you. They crucified me for claiming that I was God, but I didn't claim I was God. Excuse me? Does anybody remember what passage we talked about yesterday that talks about another Jesus? Remember what we talked about, Paul's great negative confession? And I mentioned that if the word faith people are right, the mess the church is in is the Apostle Paul's fault? Because boy, did he issue a negative confession when he said, look, I'm afraid for you little children, lest as the serpent deceived Eve by his craftiness, your mind should be led astray from the simplicity and purity of devotion to Christ. For if one comes and preaches what? Another Jesus whom we've not preached, or you receive a what? Different
gospel.
Spirit comes before the gospel. There's a counterfeit spirit which you have not received, or a counterfeit gospel, you bear this beautifully. So, absolutely right. Examine yourself to see if you're in the faith, but you better make sure it's the biblical faith, Because the problem right now is you've got a lot of people who say, yes, I love Jesus. The question is, which one?
Yeah, and the thing that you're saying about Kenneth Copeland, just recently, I don't know if anybody saw, there was a clip where he's basically gone public saying that there's no difference between the evangelical faith and the Catholic faith, joining hands. There's a very telling YouTube on that. And I don't know if you know this. This happens to be something I had. It's on page 92 in my book. This is in the 1994 Catechism of the Catholic Church. Listen carefully. Let us rejoice then and give thanks that we have become not only Christians, but Christ himself. This is the Catholic Catechism. Do you understand and grasp, brethren, God's grace towards us? Marvel and rejoice. We have become Christ. That's number 795 in the Catechism. Then number 460, for the Son of God became man so that we might become God. And then in that same one, the only begotten Son of God, wanting to make us sharers in his divinity, assumed our nature so that he made man might make men gods. And we're being told that, hey, we've got everything in common with the Catholic Church. It's there. And a lot of Catholics don't know it's there. And if somebody says, well, you know, God's in everything, it's right there in the Catechism. Oh, I guess so. And I guess the Pope approved it. So these are very serious, and it's no surprise that... Yeah. Kenneth Copeland is doing that.
Well, you know, if it were just Kenneth Copeland, we could say, well, it's just Kenneth Copeland. But I mean, we've got quotes like this from dozens of people. Richard Foster, in the first edition of his book, A Celebration of Discipline, I've got it in here if anybody wants to see it, dig it out of my little portable ammunition dump. It's on the right-hand side on the bottom of the pile, right cover, where he says, for example, good. Thank you, Pastor. Yeah, let me give you his direct quote, because it is really horrifying, the things that he's teaching you and the way that he believes that you can actually encounter Jesus. For example, on page 26, he's talking about using techniques of guided imagery visualization, time-honored in shamanism, the occult, witchcraft, paganism, the development of psychic abilities. It's how I learned how to become a psychic and a medium. And he says, using these techniques, he said, as you enter the story, he's talking about the story of Jesus and his life, his death, his resurrection, etc. As you enter the story, not as a passive observer, simply remembering, in other words, the story and the account of Scripture, but as an active participant, remember that since Jesus lives in the eternal now, and is not bound by time, this event in the past is a living present tense experience for him. Now listen to this. Hence, you can actually encounter the living Christ in the event, be addressed by his voice, be touched by his healing power. It can be more than an exercise of the imagination. It can be a genuine confrontation. Jesus Christ will actually come to you. Remember those of you who watched Lakeland, Florida, and Todd Bentley with the blasphemous buffoonery that was masquerading as revival in Florida recently? Jesus Christ has revealed to me he's going to step foot on this stage. And Wendy Alec of God TV, God has revealed to me Jesus Christ is going to appear and set literal physical foot on this stage. And all the reporters are sitting around saying, okay, well, he's not under here, he's not under there, here he is, there he is, everywhere he is, but he ain't here. Which Jesus gave them that revelation? So, confirm yourself in the faith, but you better make sure you know which faith and which God and which Jesus.
And I remember last night that gal that Carol had on that was talking about contemplative prayer. She had a kind of an unusual name, Lithuania or something like that. But did you notice she talked about disciplines? So we're celebration of discipline, the discipline of Jesus talking to you, contemplative prayer. It's all kind of coming together, and really, what he's saying right there is Jesus is calling out to you. Are you hearing him? And it's almost like, you know, have you heard Jesus lately? You haven't? I mean, it's almost like in the old days where, you know, do you speak in tongues? You don't. You know, it's like there's getting to be this kind of like this thing where you're not really a full-fledged spirit-filled Christian unless you're hearing the voice of Jesus. And a lot of the leaders are setting that kind of as a standard. It's very dangerous.
Yeah. And, you know, just to add to that, when people say to you, or if you yourself are saying, oh, God, give me a word, I saw a little cartoon recently. Don't ask me in what, but it was wonderful. Here is this little stick figure of a man, and he's praying, "Oh, Jesus, I want to hear a word from you. Oh, God, give me a word from you." And the heavenly hand comes down out of heaven with this in it.
Yeah. And that leads me right into this point number two. Thank you.
Anytime.
Measure everything by the word of God. There are all sorts of scriptures that you're probably familiar with. Carol, are you coming up here with us? Come on. She's hiding back there.
Not for long.
Everything needs to be measured by the word of God. And that's why, you know, anything, any of these new books that are coming out, you have to compare what's being said. And if you hear this is new revelation, remember some of the things that I read from the Jesus of Jesus calling where new truths are flowing in, you know, it's like, no. This is extra biblical. The Bible is sufficient. It has everything. I came out of the most amazing deception. So did Johanna. So did Carol. And the Bible has given us everything that we need to know about what's going on today. It's just an amazing book.
But let me add to that. A verse taken out of context is a pretext. Mm-hmm. Everything we need is in Scripture. The Lord has given us everything we need for godliness and faithfulness to walk by faith in the power of the Spirit, not in the power of the flesh. But be careful of people who claim they're using the word and then twist it all out of context. For example, we mentioned numerous times Psalm 46, right? How many of you heard, "Be still and know that I am God," as the excuse now for going into an altered state of consciousness, taking a word, saying it over and over, right? What is the context of the passage? Remember what we were talking about? Was it yesterday or the day before? The rest of the story. What? What's the guy's name you
Paul
told me?
Paul Harvey.
Paul Harvey. I keep wanting to call him Howard Cosell. Why is that? I don't know. What is the rest of the story? Read Psalm 46. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth should change, though the mountains slip into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains quake at its swelling pride. Then, let me move to verse 8. Come, behold the works of the Lord who has wrought desolations in the earth. He makes wars to cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow, he cuts the spear in two. He burns the chariots with fire. Cease striving and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord God of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold. What is he saying? He's saying, chill out. I'm in control. Not go into your place of mystical stillness and enter an altered state of consciousness. Context, people. Without context, you've got nothing. Even the devil quoted scripture to Jesus, twisted out of context.
It's not a call to meditation. And it's being repeated by a lot of people, including Sarah Young, to make it look like it is. And she's even got her Jesus saying just that. And we've got that quote in there where he's, you know, I gave you that. You know, I want you to go into a meditative state and contemplative prayer and to listen to me. Number three that I've got back here is 2 Corinthians 2:11. Lest Satan should get an advantage of us, for we're not ignorant of his devices. Well, that one is, you know, for a lot of us that have been deceived in various ways, it's like we have to, you know, as a body, warn one another. I was mentioning, and I just heard a story just a few minutes ago about another person who tried to talk to somebody about Jesus calling. They didn't want to hear it. They got angry. You know, we need to try to communicate to each other when something isn't right, and we need to be aware of those devices. We're to be simple regarding evil, it says, but it also says that we're not to be ignorant of his devices. Mm-hmm. So we don't need to know all the little tricks, but they're the major ones we need to be really aware of because they're coming in. And one of the most insidious is a book like The Message, which just completely perverts the word of God and is probably setting the standard for the Bible that we're going to see in the future that's going to be more of a agreed upon even New World Bible someday. And that book needs to be written by somebody that would really expose just how bad the message is. There's quite a bit online.
And, you know, I think just to add another verse to that, Warren, because you're absolutely right, we need to know the no football coach, not that I've ever seen a game of football, so what do I know? But I know this much. No coaches of a football team go into a game without studying the tactics of the other team, right? They do it in baseball, they do it in basketball, they do it in football. They know the tactics of the opposing team. No general goes into battle without studying the thinking, the tactics, the basis of the opposing general and the opposing army. We go waddling into battle without knowing what a scheme is, and then we wonder why we are devastated, shredded. And we need to remember what the Lord gives us in Ephesians chapter 6. Finally, be strong in the Lord, beginning in verse 10, and in the strength of his might. Put on the full armor of God that you may stand firm against the schemes, the devices, the tactics, the wiles of the devil. And if you know at least the basics, deception is his biggest scheme. If the devil can get you to believe that he's a figment of your imagination, and that if you're a Christian and you're really sincere, you can't be deceived, he has already defeated you. And you have gone waddling out into the battlefield, stark knocky-died, and then you're wondering why you've got all kinds of arrows sticking out of some really uncomfortable parts of your anatomy. Put on the full armor of God, then you can stand firm against the schemes of the devil. And that armor is Jesus Christ himself, his righteousness, his belt of truth, the firm foundation of the gospel of peace, the helmet of salvation to protect your thinking, your mind, lest your mind be led astray from the simplicity and purity of devotion to Christ, where you're taking up the shield of faith with which you quench all the flaming missiles of the evil one, and then you pick up the sword of the Spirit, which is your one offensive weapon, the Word of God, which you better have hidden in your heart and memorized, because that's the one that identifies the schemes of the devil and equips you so that as Jesus handled devil when he showed up on his doorstep, right, in the wilderness after the 40 days, he could stand back and say, yeah, devil, you're quoting this to me, but it is written. And that is what we need to come back with to defeat those schemes of the devil.
Yeah, I think the analogy of the sports where they're always studying the opposition, that's not happening. It was going on quite a bit in the 80s, maybe the early 90s, at least to some extent. But if the trumpet gives an uncertain sound, 1 Corinthians 14:8, who shall prepare himself for the battle? When you watch a clip of someone like Beth Moore, she's warning about us. Their opposition, the ones that they're studying, are the people that are going against them rather than being good Bereans and going to the Word of God. So to let someone like Oprah just run free and for Rick Warren to sashay onto her program like it was no big deal, Joel Osteen was on there, T.D. Jakes was on there. You know, this is like sitting down with Simon the Sorcerer and talking about God. You know, it just doesn't make any sense. Or even better, to have Dr. Oz, who's a major occultist. I had some booklets here about the Daniel Plan. I didn't have many and they went quickly, but in the back of A Wonderful Deception, I have what Dr. Oz is involved in. And the first time that I saw this Daniel Plan with Rick Warren pulling Dr. Oz, you know, major New Age occultist, probably a very good doctor. Oh, okay, yeah, hold it up, yeah. Probably a very good doctor. I mean, you know, and he probably has lots of good health tips, and that pulls people in. But the very first time I went to Rick Warren's website, and I saw Dr. Oz, and it said, click here to go to Dr. Oz's website. I clicked, went to Dr. Oz's website, and the first thing I saw was New York City, want to talk to the dead? He was having a program with John Edward talking, you know, facilitating people talking to their dead relatives. He has a front page endorsement on a book by a psychic, and the word spirit guide is, I think it's like 175 times in the book. Absolutely no discernment. His wife's a Reiki master. He's into yoga, transcendental meditation, and now he's got a magazine just like Oprah's. These things are just flying, and I don't know that I've ever heard anybody, you know, Christian leadership really talk about what Dr. Oz is really into.
You've well, got I, Carol you, has.
Well, yeah, you're a leader.
Red, that means the battery's dead, right?
Carol, here.
Oh, no, oh, it's not on. No, here.
Oh, here's one. It's on now. Okay, thank you. Thanks. I was actually going to mention that the other two people in the Daniel Plan are actually even more almost, I don't think Satan can be any more satanic, so to speak. But
it's not coming through very good.
Okay, it's right up to my mouth. This is as close as I can get. Is that all right?
Yes.
Is that okay? Are you still shaking your head?
It's coming out of Chuck's monitor, but I don't think it's coming out of the mains.
Okay. Well, is that better? Another one of the people involved in Rick Warren's Daniel plan is a doctor called Amen. Daniel Amen. Now, he is an interesting person because here again, I'm not saying that he's not a good doctor by any means. And of course, this is where Rick Warren says that he is going to use the three doctors for their well-being and health, and he doesn't care about what spiritual messages they give. The danger with that is that Dr. Daniel Amen introduces people to a 12-minute meditation called Satanama. Now, Satanama can be given by gurus in India. This is a very vital kundalini snake arousal meditation, which he says for 12 minutes, and this again was clicking at the time, just clicking from Rick Warren's page into Daniel Amen's page, who encouraged people to get into this 12-minute meditation of calling down the demons in the mantra Satanama. Well, all you have to do is spell that out, and I'm not going to get any of you to say it, but S-A-T-A-N-A. This is not a complicated name for Satan. So you're chanting this name, awakening the snake power within you. What is Rick Warren thinking about bringing these kind of doctors into the purpose-driven plan, the purpose-driven church, where he is also the pastor, or the purpose-driven churches are 40,000 churches around the world. This purpose-driven life and purpose-driven church and purpose-driven program is all over the world. So this is now being introduced through health and wellness, just as yoga is coming into the West. Through health and wellness, we are being introduced into satanic possession that comes in, and we don't even know what's happening. I'm going to have a little aside here. I have got an absolute incredible praise to give us. Here we are at the end of a conference where we've been talking about discernment, and I thank you, everybody that's come, the people who are listening, and I hope your eyes and ears and heart have been opened enough to ask questions. One young lady came to me, and that was the reason I'm a little late here, and said that she had some worries and concerns and that she was involved in health work, body work. She wanted power. She wanted healing. She believed she was a Christian. And this young lady has come to the Lord as of half an hour ago and given her life to the Lord, denounced all the things she was involved in. And so we were involved in prayer at the back. And I'm just so grateful to the Lord for bringing her from death to life, because her heart and mind were open enough to confess what she'd been involved in, which was satanic work, which she didn't even know she was being involved with demons and the very types of things that Rick Warren's doctors are introducing us to in this health work. So I'm very, very grateful to the Lord for bringing Lena into the kingdom. We've got a new baby sister in the Lord here. And thank you very much.
I'm going to jump in here for just a moment. There was something I wanted to point out this morning. I didn't. I kind of forgot or got too worked up or something. But historically, every true spiritual revival has been characterized by a return to the Word of God, a renewed passion and desire for the Word of God. Most recently, it was the Jesus movement of the 70s. And again, the Calvary Chapel was at the forefront. They weren't the only group, but definitely a very important part of that spiritual revival, which started in Southern California and spread all over the whole world. But it was characterized by, there was this massive change from people going to church and the pastor getting up and reading one verse and then telling two or three or four stories, to actually getting into the Bible, studying the Bible verse by verse, chapter by chapter, book by book, as Paul told the Ephesian elders in the book of Acts, I have not failed to bring to you the whole counsel of God. Not just the parts that you want to hear, not just the parts that you like, not just the parts that make you feel good, but the whole of Scripture. I mean, all the way back to the days of King Josiah in ancient Judah, they rediscovered the manuscripts of the Word of God, and Josiah brought those forth and began to read them to the people, and that there was a great revival in the land of Judah. Now, there's a common thread amongst all these groups we've been talking about this week, and they run the whole gamut, as we've talked, from Pentecostal to Baptist, and they're all kind of converging in the middle somewhere. But there's a common thread, and that is every one of these groups is out there preaching that we're going to have this amazing, incredible, worldwide revival, whereas the Bible says just the opposite. There's going to be a great falling away. And as they preach this, you know, exciting, motivational message, there's absolutely no emphasis whatsoever on the Word of God. It's all about feelings. It's all about experience. They throw a Bible verse here and there just to make it sound legit. Would you guys agree with that? And if you know what to look for, it is so extremely obvious. If it's a genuine move of God, everybody's going to be just dying to get into the Word, into the Scriptures, to study the Word, to quote the Word. But that's not what's happening with these people. It's just the opposite. And so I wanted to throw that in. And I wanted to throw a question out. Carol, go ahead.
Oh, and I was going to add to that. Oh, my goodness, I'm so sorry. Hello, is this one better? Yeah, there we go. I was going to add to that, the one interesting way that everything is being brought together is through the body. See, it's body wellness, body health, having power over health, having power over becoming better. Now, within Eastern mysticism, the idea is body, mind, and spirit are one. So if the body is becoming the emphasis, it is in contrast to what the Bible asks us, that Jesus came and died on the cross to bring our spirit to life, that we are being given eternal life through the Spirit of God so that we can have eternal life resurrected through his death and having everlasting life with him. We cannot have everlasting body work, everlasting good health work. So, but when Rick Warren starts introducing good, happy health to 40,000 churches all over the world and all his congregants and other people come through health and yoga promises health, realize that Paul said that it's good for us to do body work. It's temporally okay. I mean, I play tennis every day. I love tennis, but I don't pretend to play Christian tennis. You know, there's no such thing. Yeah. So we can't have Christian yoga and Christian wellness. Of course, we need to eat sensibly, and we need to look after our bodies for good health. But let's get back to what Jesus died for, to tell people that they have lost their spirit. Their spirit is dead. The wages of sin is death. And we have been given eternal life through the work of Jesus Christ on the cross. And I think you'll find that's the common thread in everything, trying to get us through having power for better body management or body health.
And hey, Warren, can I ask something real quick?
Sure.
Because I know this is an issue that comes up with a lot of people. They say, well, it's wrong, it's unchristian to publicly name these people by name, to criticize them, to, you know, take them on as I do and as you guys do. A lot of people get very offended by that, and they say, that's wrong, it's not Christ-like, you shouldn't be attacking these people. How would you respond to that?
Well, Paul did.
Yeah.
And Alexander the coppersmith and
right.
Just numerous others, Hymenaeus and
Hymenaeus, Demas in John. The most notable example being in Galatians chapter 2, where Paul confronted Peter and Barnabas when they were compromising the gospel with the Judaizers and called them hypocrites to their face twice. And we're reading about it 2,000 years later. Look, I appreciate a reluctance and a hesitancy to name names. We don't do so lightly. I know none of us sitting here just tosses out a name because we didn't like the color tie they were wearing that afternoon, and we cherry-picked a piece or two out of something they said and figured that they were worth bringing down because of that. That is not our heart and our motive. But all through Scripture, you read about the importance of contending earnestly for the faith, where the Apostle Paul, as you quoted from Acts 20, where he said, I declare to you, I am free from the guilt of the blood of all men because I did not hesitate to declare to you the full counsel of the word of God. He said, remember, after my departure, savage wolves will arise, and they're going to bring destruction among the flock of God. So remember, for 3 years I warned you with tears, and he named some of these guys by name. Demas, Alexander the coppersmith, Hymenaeus. So when it is important to contend for the faith, and you need to know, look, we're way beyond. When these men are writing books in public, printing hundreds of thousands of copies, you cannot just go running off to, this isn't a Matthew 18 where they've personally offended Warren or Carrill or you, Pastor, or me. This is something they are teaching on a mass scale in public, and it needs to be dealt with on a mass scale in public, even as the Apostle Paul dealt with Peter and Barnabas. And by the way, if anybody could have stood up and said, how dare you confront and challenge God's anointed, it would have been Peter. But he received and accepted the rebuke. How do I know? Because in 2 Peter chapter 3, written a long time after this incident in Galatians chapter 2, he talks about our beloved brother Paul, some of whose writings are a little hard to understand, which the untaught and the unstable distort as they do the rest of Scripture to their own destruction. He received the rebuke. Why? Because he had a truly humble heart before the Lord. And when he received the correction, which he knew was from the Holy Spirit and from God, reprove, rebuke, correct, he accepted it and turned around. And the gospel, the integrity of the word of God was preserved because of that. Yeah. Where is that kind of heart among people like Benny Hinn, who go hissing like snakes when challenged? I curse those who come against my ministry. I mean, it's like listening to the voice of this of the devil himself. Instead of saying, wait a minute, is there something I need to examine here? Is something I'm teaching and think is from God not matching up with Scripture? Like the Bereans that you've mentioned. You know, when the Apostle Paul talk about the great Apostle Paul coming to present a truth, he goes to the Bereans, and if anybody could have said, how dare you question me? I'm Paul, Damascus Road experience, 15 years studying. Jesus himself gave me revelation. But the Bereans grilled him like a chicken. Oh, really? You say Jesus revealed what to you? Huh, okay, Psalm 22. Ah, okay, check. Ooh, Isaiah 52 and 53. Okay, check. They went straight down the line. People, if the two hadn't matched, if Paul's words hadn't matched the scrolls of the scriptures that they had, guess which one would have found himself back in the middle of the Damascus Road? I'll give you a hint. Would have been the scroll of Isaiah.
I don't think it would have been too helpful if I had hinted at a book that was really popular this morning and made real kind of off the back wall comments. You have to go right at it. When somebody's putting words in Jesus' mouth, or purporting that these are Jesus' words, we need to look at Scripture and see if these really are consistent. I want to just do this thing about body health. I think this is a really important point. It's a little bit off the subject, but the whole idea of this God in everything is that when everybody gets it, you know, do you get it? Do you get it that God's in his creation? Each one of us is reputedly a cell in the body of Christ, of God. The world is the body of God. Each cell needs to be responsible for the health of the body. If a cell, you or me, does not recognize that we are God, then we are regarded by the New Age, New Spirituality, and I think starting to come into the faith, we are regarded as needing healing or elimination. In my book, False Christ Coming, it's pretty horrifying. Barbara Marks Hubbard, a key New Age leader, actually was nominated for vice president at the Democratic National Convention in 1984. This is not some fluffy lady off on the sidelines, and she's right there right now at the front of this whole New Age network. And she's been on Oprah recently. They're bringing her on. I think they had her on an unrelated matter, but they're bringing her in. She said that Christ has told her that those that do not subscribe to their own divinity are truly the only satanic ones. The only thing satanic in the new world order is to not recognize your own divinity. So we will be regarded, when we deny that everyone is God and that we are God, we will be regarded as cancer cells. And these are the words of the Christ that Barbara Marx Hubbard is channeling to the world and to the New Age. They even have a name for it, the selection process, which is part of an evolutionary process. Man is supposedly evolving. We don't get it. We're the dinosaur brains. We're the slow ones. We're starting to hear that even from Beth Moore. The scoffers are coming. Turn to the person on your left. So this is happening very quickly, and the persecution's coming. Jesus said, they hated me, they're going to hate you. They persecuted me, they're going to persecute you. They called me Beelzebub, Satan, they're going to call you Beelzebub, Satan. You know, this is not a feel-good, I mean, Jesus calling, when you really look at what's being said, it's just like, don't worry, you're going to be with me in heaven, we're going to take that quantum leap together, don't hesitate to go out on a limb with me, take the road less traveled, you know, my heart aches, you know, I want to be, come on. You know, this is like, it's just unbelievable kid stuff that's not even true. We're in a very serious battle, as Johanna was describing, and we have to be aware of what's going on. But that's what a lot of this health stuff is, because it's all going to tie in with the spirit that Carol was talking about, body, mind, spirit. That's what we, you know, that was holistic was totally a New Age term. Now it's completely in the faith. Things like divine alchemy, all these overlapping terms are now in the Christian faith. Things that used to be telltale signs where you could say, oh, that's definitely New Age. Now we've got light bearer and things like that that are being incorporated into all these new teachings.
And I think another way that it comes into the church, because we all know we're not divine. In fact, the girl that we interviewed, I mean, the movie we showed last night of Felina, she said, I'm not God. And I don't pretend to be God, and God, I'm not in control of God. But it comes into the church through power. The Christians will say, I want to have power to heal. I want to have the energy to heal. Now, you see, this is terminology that a Christian will use, but we don't have that power. So the moment that you usurp that power, you have taken a divine right. It's only the Holy Spirit that has the power to heal according to his will. So when hundreds and thousands of Christians are being trained to be involved in Reiki, energy, meridian healing, to have power to heal and call it in the name of Jesus Christ, they're still taking a power from the spirit world that does not belong to us. So remember, it doesn't necessarily need to be called divinity or divine, but even power, well-being, in anything that you can have that energy. And I think coming back to name-calling, Jesus, of all people, was the one that gave the greatest and most horrific names to the hierarchy in the so-called religious world at the time, that they were whitewashed tombs. They were sepulchres. They were, I mean, those are horrible terms of whitewashed bones, dead people. These were religious people that Jesus had the strongest names for. Why? Not because he was undermining their characters, but because they had the audacity to take God's word and redefine it. And I think that's what we need to have a passion about, which is what I think Joe, Warren, Ray, myself have, is that we hate to see God's word undermined, because we were part of those who were deceived and did the very, very same deception, undermining the word of God, undermining the power of God, et cetera, et cetera.
He called them vipers, too.
Vipers, snakes.
Snakes, that's right.
And now we have the church telling us that we can bring that viper power, that kundalini power, into us through chakra practice.
Johanna, I'll ask you a question. You said you're not a cessationist. Neither am I. We believe in the gifts of the Holy Spirit, right? We believe that God, Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. God still does miracles, right? So how do you explain, at least from outward appearances, it doesn't seem that we are seeing, unless it's being counterfeited like these groups are doing, but oftentimes it doesn't seem like we see the same level of miraculous power being exhibited in the church today that we saw in the book of Acts. I know that's a concern for a lot of people, and that's how a lot of people get sucked into this. And you experience the other side powerfully, right? And you were delivered. So that's the power of God at work to deliver you from that. But again, this longing people have, they read it in the scriptures, and they say, I want to see that happening here and now. How do we
well,
you know,
you know, the thing is, I
rectify
think
all
it,
that?
It's when you look at scripture, you see something really important. It is in order that you may know that the Son of God has authority on earth to forgive sins, that he says to the paralytic, rise up, take up your pallet, and go home. It isn't for the sake of the miracle itself. There is something much greater than a physical healing. Keep in mind that Paul said to Timothy, hey, son, take a little wine for your stomach and your frequent ailments. Paul is the one who said, look, it was because of a bodily illness I first preached the gospel to you. I bear you witness, you would have plucked out your own eyes if you could have to help me. Epaphroditus, he left sick at Miletus, and he said, God had mercy on me, lest he should have died, and I would have had sorrow upon sorrow. You see great miracles in Scripture, but you also see they're performed in accordance with God's own will and for a purpose. Paul didn't heal everybody. Peter didn't heal everybody. The great physician is the Lord Jesus Christ, but he used a doctor, Dr. Luke, to write two of the books in the New Testament. I don't think that's a coincidence. He wasn't saying, unless God zaps you spiritually instantly, which, by the way, he can. My husband has been healed instantly. He had a back problem, by the way, much the same as I, and we went to God knowing full well he could heal. Right, my beloved of 38 years, his name is Randolph. I don't know if he's watching tonight. Hi, beloved, if you are. You know, when we were first married, he damaged his spine. He really needed surgery. Didn't have any way of doing it. Couldn't get out of bed. Couldn't put on his socks. Terrible pain for several years. We went to the Lord in prayer and interceded, and we had a group of people pray for him. God miraculously, one night on the seventh night, the seventh week, we felt this incredible heat coming from my beloved's back. He said, don't touch me. It was like he was baking all night long. The next morning, he got up. He said, I can move. My back is healed. He jumps into his little gym shorts, and he goes and plays two courts of basketball and gives himself tendonitis. But his back was healed. Yeah. Me? I had a similar back problem. Years of physical therapy, years of pain medication, spinal epidurals, finally had surgery. My back is still falling apart. Does that mean God loves me less than he does my beloved? Oh, no. Because I know full well that I walk by faith, not by sight, that the living God can heal me instantly. But sometimes he says to us, as he said to Paul, my grace is sufficient for you. When we ask for him three times to remove whatever this thorn in the flesh is, his grace is sufficient. We learn to walk by faith, not by sight, as we trust him, whether he heals us instantly and we rejoice in that and he can do it, or whether he says, walk by faith, trusting me, because there's something worse than a physical illness. I saw people getting healed with the medium in Mexico City. What did they pay in a price? Satan gives nothing for free. When you go to some of these people, the big name so-called healers, with the we're having a miracle healing revival at 7 o'clock, the Holy Spirit is going to show up and he's going to knock people over and he's going to heal you. And you see most of those people wheeled out again, and some of them even dying in ambulances on the way out the door, as has happened at Benny Hinn conferences and other places. What happens to the faith of those people? They're left thinking, God doesn't love me as much. Oh, that's a lie out of the pit of hell. But look at the balance of the Word of God and learn to trust him regardless. And don't go even to the psychic healers who masquerade under the name of Jesus. But which Jesus are they healing under? Is it another Jesus, a different spirit, a different gospel? And what is the price they're paying for that healing?
Yeah, and I think you're absolutely right, Johanna. The greatest miracle God did is that he died for our sins. And that's the point, that every miracle points to that person being forgiven of their sins. And that was the miraculous miracle we had a little earlier in the hour ago, where somebody was healed of their sin and has come into everlasting life. And I think we must never lose our sight on that the Lord Jesus Christ gave his blood that we can have eternal life, and any healing is secondary.
And again, when we put an overemphasis on the signs and wonders and all that, it downplays, like you say, what is the greatest miracle? The greatest healing is the healing of our spirits when we're born again and we're saved and we're set free and we're given. How can anything be greater than that? What does it profit a man if he gains the whole world, loses his own soul?
And you know, I think that's an important thing. In Nigeria, I was just speaking to a young woman whom I've known since she was an infant, practically. And she spent quite a number of months in Nigeria. And she said, you know, there, Christian nation, everybody's a Christian, even the Christian pastors. But the minute one of them gets sick, who do they run to? Do they look to the Lord? Do they trust him to do whatever he wants in accordance with his will? No. They go running off to the witch doctors, to the shamans, and they get their healing there. And what happens there? What price are they paying? She was telling me that there have been numerous cases, even of pastors, who found themselves going into a blank trance state and murdering someone because they knew that was part of the payment the spirit was demanding for the healing and the restoration of their child. What price? When I went back and I was tracking down some of the people who'd received incredible healings through Pachita, some had become alcoholics, a number had become psychics and were mediums themselves. What price does the devil extract for a physical healing, and is it worth your eternal soul and walking by faith in the living God? When you know the God in whom you've placed your faith, you can dare to walk by faith, even if that means carrying arthritis in your body. And you can learn to say, God, change my spirit from being a cranky, nasty old lady when I get hurting. Ask Carol, she knows. Yeah, when I get mean and cranky and nasty and mean as a snake, Lord, I'm walking by faith. Yes, you could heal me, but maybe you're doing something greater in me and transforming my character by God's grace into the image of Jesus Christ, which maybe wouldn't happen if I were healed. And by the way, we are seeing healings all the time. And we do see miracles all the time. We just saw one now. And we do see God intervening with a word of knowledge and even a true prophecy, which, by the way, is more of a declaring with power the word of God than a thus saith the Lord. Tomorrow there'll be a big earthquake in California, which if there is, oh well. Yeah. There's something greater than that. We see these not on the big stages of the so-called Catherine Kuhlmans, and I'm sorry, I personally kind of have a problem with Catherine Kuhlman, sweet Pastor Chuck, to the contrary. You know, I look at the abilities. Did you ever see the Lord Jesus Christ or the Apostle Paul or Peter or James or John? This afternoon, we're having a great healing meeting. Hallelujah. You know, and you manipulate the people with the music over and over. And then you have the great healings, and most of them are. What is that? It's in the context of one-on-one that you see the miracles of the Lord take place. And they're happening everywhere. It's just not as the human eye would expect it to happen. So we're looking to man, not to God, from man's perspective, not God's perspective. Big mistake.
Exactly. And remember that the Lord said of the end times like this, that it is an evil generation that is looking for signs and wonders. And what's happening within the New Apostolic Kansas City Fellowship, International House of Prayer, prophetic movement, is that signs and wonders is the emphasis. And if you have signs and wonders as the emphasis instead of the incredible wonder of the God who sent his only begotten Son to set us free from eternal death and separation from him, then we have missed the real, real focus. Yes.
And you know, keep in mind, the Lord looked wistfully about him and he said, will the Son of Man find faith on earth when he returns? Not the stuff, the faith, once for all delivered to the saints. Contend earnestly for the stuff. The signs, the wonders, the miracles? I don't think so. Preach the stuff. Be ready in season, out of season. Heal, slain in the spirit. Raise that. I don't think so. Preach the word. Be ready in season, out of season, right? Reprove, rebuke. It was the exhortation to Timothy, in which, by the way, read 1st and 2nd Timothy. Not only do you see a lot about doctrine, you'll see a lot of names mentioned. Hey, Timothy, watch out for these guys. Read 1st and 2nd Timothy. And what is it that's preached? It's sound doctrine. If God chooses in accordance with his own will, 1 Corinthians 12, 1 Corinthians 14, to bring a sign or a wonder or a tongue or an interpretation or a miracle or a prophecy in accordance with his will, praise God. But it's in the context of the preaching of the word and the true word of salvation in the gospel, not in seeking after signs and wonders and miracles, because there is where the counterfeit comes in and deceives the unsuspecting, because you're looking for the wrong thing. You're looking for the gift, not the giver.
Number five, do not seek signs and wonders and spiritual experiences.
Amen.
Hey, Warren, we're probably running out of time. Out of what you have, what's the most important thing?
I'll just read the scripture there.
You want to key in on it.
I'm sort of putting a period at the end of her paragraph.
Right, no, I know, okay. Yeah. What do you have there that would be the most important thing you want to key in as we close out this part?
Well, I'll just give the scripture from Mark 8:12, and the true Jesus Christ sighed deeply in his spirit and said, "Why does this generation seek after a sign? Verily, I say unto you, there shall be no sign be given unto this generation." I think maybe the one that sticks out here, maybe a good one to finish with, is to pray for discernment. Ask the Lord to give you. I mean, that's what, when we first were believers, we would read the Bible and it was like, what does this mean? Lord, can you help us to understand this scripture? Because we know it's true, but we don't get it. And the Lord will do that. And pray for discernment, ask the one true God, as did Solomon, for spiritual discernment. God came to Solomon in a dream, 1 Kings 3:9, and said, you can have anything you want. And he said he wanted to be able to discern between good and evil. I mean, and it said that the Lord was really pleased with that.
And have wisdom.
Yeah.
And have wisdom.
So, you know, you can pray for discernment, ask God for discernment, but, you know, I just learned early on, you always pray, God's will be done. You know, whatever you're asking for, your will be done. I remember reading about, I think it was John or Paul Yonggi Cho over there. He kept asking, double my church, double my church, double my church. And the church kept getting doubled. And then he ended up with this monstrous, you know, church that was way off the rails.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And a tremendous amount of pride. So it's God's will be done. It may seem like it's making sense what you're asking for, but, you know, but you know best, Lord. So, yeah, I think that's just a good one.
But, you know, I would add one thing to that, because, Warren, you're absolutely right. We need, you know, never mind the gifts of prophecy and healing and miracles, which, by the way, you notice nobody's standing in line crying out to God for the gift of hospitality and administration. Oh, God, give me the gift of administration. Yeah, right. But let me tell you something. God may give you indeed the gift of discernment. Cry out to him for that. It is pleasing in his sight. But Hebrews chapter 5, verse 14, but solid food is for the mature, who because of practice have their senses trained to discern good and evil. You don't need a true supernatural gift of discernment, although we should all cry out to God for it. You learn to discern as you compare the experiences, the theology, the teachings, the practices against the word of God. And any child of 5 or 6 or 8 can learn to test the spirits in accordance to the word of God and know that the Holy Spirit will reveal to you what is false and what is true. The question is, do you really want to know?
Let me make it really clear. I was not saying you should pray for the gift of discernment, that you should pray that you would be more discerning. So that when you pick up a book like The Shack or The Message, that God would give you discernment.
Amen to that.
And I had one more thing with that we have to be able to understand lying spirits. Because this sweet sister that came to the Lord this evening truly believed the liars. And they come as the God of confusion. We have to understand that the God of confusion, the God of doubt, the liar, the destroyer, the thief, the cheat, these are all very, very enticing. These are the doctrines of demons that persuade us. But, you know, always the Holy Spirit gives you an inkling. She knew. She knew something was wrong. So listen to the Lord telling us what's wrong, and then come to brothers and sisters and pastors like your wonderful Pastor Gary here, this incredible church, who's got the ability to be able to pray over us. So thank you very, very much for your time.
Amen.
And all glory and praise and honor to the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. We all need discernment. And like Joanna said, we don't need the spiritual gift of discernment, although it's wonderful to have and wonderful to ask for. But we get discernment by knowing what Jesus taught, what Jesus said, what Jesus did. We put everything against Jesus. We discern the spirits through the Holy Spirit. This is what we need to do in these times. So much false light, so much false love, so much false spirituality running rampant. The series is coming to a close. There'll be maybe one or two more episodes, I'm not sure yet. But I hope through this series, you can understand what we're trying to say. Don't fall for the counterfeit Jesus. There's one true Jesus. One way, one truth, one life, one light, one path, and it's a narrow one. It's not a broad one. We love all, but we don't condone all. There's a big difference. Remember, sometimes true love means true correction. Don't forget to pray for the children, our fellow brothers and sisters, and those lost, so that they too can be found. I'll see you next time.